Welcome to the Bishop Hour, hosted by Bishop Michael Evans from the Donai Ministry, 1727 Causeway Street, Baltimore, Maryland.
Good evening, my brothers and my sisters. Good to hear y'all again. Here we go again. We've been away for a minute, but we're back. We're back in the swing of things now. But tonight, we're going to be talking about the Ministry of Reconciliation. I have a personal young lady here. I'm going to have her introduce herself, but she's been in the gang. We're going to talk about it a little bit. We can't get so far in it, but she can talk to you about her experience and what made her go into it and so forth and so on. But just in case someone is listening and maybe struggling in this area too, you can call tonight at 1-855-493-6499. That's 1-855-493-6499. So we call this the Ministry of Reconciliation, for the Word of God said that now we are all things of God, who have reconciled us back to Himself through Jesus Christ, has given us the Ministry of Reconciliation. That is God was in Christ reconciling the world to Himself, and so now we're ambassadors of Jesus Christ. So I just want to introduce you to Jovan Lane. Amen. My niece, one of the members of my church. Yes. Love the Lord. God is doing some God is doing some great things in her life. You know, she really not proven to me, but you proven to God that this is who God has called her to be. And so I'm excited. So Jovan, come on, talk to us. Introduce yourself. Amen.
Good evening, everybody. My name is Jovan Lane. I don't really know too much more to say before I'm introducing myself.
Okay, all right.
Remember, I don't know how ministry has been there since the beginning. And I guess that's pretty much it as far as introducing myself.
All right. Praise God. Now, Jovan, you have been in gang. Tell us what drew you to the gangs in the beginning.
Pretty much. I mean, I was in a situation where I had decided for whatever reasons that I wanted to sell drugs. So at the time I was selling coke. Mm-hmm. And the area that I was in, it was becoming more and more populated with gangs. Mm-hmm. And so they decided that anybody that was going to be a part of the drug trade in that particular area, in that particular community, that they was going to have to pay a tax. And then I just got to the point where I just felt like, I don't know, I'm a thinker, so I felt like it was just smarter to join them. You know, I'm like, man, I want to keep a couple dollars in my pocket, so I don't know. It was just smarter than me. Yeah, it was better to join them.
Okay. So it wasn't no other thing like you was looking for love, looking for relationship?
Yeah, the thing is, I mean, I come from like a very strong family, a very strong background. I always felt love, and I always felt it means enough of us. So if I needed to be protected, you know, I always felt like I could have that protection. And I mean, that's a good question, because what I learned is like like at least 95% of people that join gangs is because they looking for protection.
Mm. You know? Oh, okay. Okay.
It just wasn't my particular deal.
So do the gang offer family, like a family atmosphere or a family connection besides protection, but like a family, you know?
Yeah. I would say they do offer in a sense of that family protection. And I mean, if you come across everybody, just clear that stigma, like everybody in the gang isn't a bad person.
Okay.
I mean, you might come across some people who just they got caught up for whatever reasons, and that they became knowledgeable even with just gangbanging and, you know, knowing the streets and stuff like that. And then they see younger children and they know for a fact that their influence is, you know, is greater than just these children's peers. So you got some people that will step in. And just to answer your question, that's why I say it's kind of like that family environment, because some of these guys will step in and be like a good father, like a good big brother, a good uncle to some of these young kids. But, I mean, it's sad to say that's just far and few. It's there, though.
Okay. All right. So now that you're in the gang and you went in for the hustle, how did it treat you in reference to what kind of benefits it brought you, or did you have benefits in the gang?
Yeah, I mean, it just opened up, like I said, it put me in a place where I wasn't subject to the tax of, you know, everybody else was around there subject to for that time, because a little over time, everybody in the community was choosing to be in one gang or another gang. It kind of started out where it was like, it was very small in numbers, but because of the weaponry and stuff that these, and the intimidation techniques and stuff that these people was using, before I knew it, everybody was in the gang. Okay. Now, it may not have been the same particular gang that I was in, but everybody start choosing. At some point, everybody was choosing to be in some type of gang or some type of organization.
Okay.
The ones who couldn't get in where they fit in the organization that I was in, they went to a different gang, mm-hmm, or a different organization. So we get to a place in this small community that I'm in. I mean, we already know Baltimore is small enough. Yeah. But the small community that I'm in, we get to a place where now you got three fully functioning gangs. So
yeah.
To throw that into the mix of what we already doing, I mean, people just start dropping like flies. You know?
So it become territorial.
Very territorial. Okay.
So can we mention the three groups? Is that allowed, or should we?
Well,
I know always the Crips and the Blood, but I heard it's the Black Gorillas or something.
Yes.
Yeah, okay. All right. So those are the three entities that people can join, mm-hmm, and have protection and kind of work pretty much.
Yes.
All right. So even though they hustle, and they really have some pull a little bit too, don't they?
What you mean?
Pull when I mean they have connections.
Yes.
With other entities beside the hustle part.
Yes.
Okay. All right. We ain't gonna have to get too far
I mean,
in
I
it.
Can't say, but I'm, I can't right, say I got so you. Much, but yeah. I mean, the whole
organizations always have that.
Yeah, fully functional organization. You got some very, very intelligent people who brought different different rules and different structures to the table, and you know, these are things that we have to live by.
Right.
And, you know, die by, mm-hmm, if need be. So the purpose is to have a how can I say it? I'm not trying to get nobody in trouble.
Right, so. Okay. We gonna have common sense here.
But in different things, I mean, they will wanna have some type of representation in every law enforcement area, every, you know, anywhere we feel
lawyers, doctors.
A lot of doctors, a lot of people would never know it.
Mm-hmm.
Like if, yeah, I mean, if we, if we, if, especially if you, especially if you are, if you made it to a different level within the organization and something was to happen to you, you absolutely are not going to the emergency room. I mean, you knock it off. Like you're, definitely,
but they have someone
yes,
to take care of you.
Yes, I mean, these are people are in the organization.
Okay, all right. So, if there are levels, because you said you didn't have to pay taxes, because, you know, you have
levels
to be in a certain levels?
Even when I first joined, it took some time before I got to a place where the taxing was removed.
You have to prove yourself?
You have to prove yourself. Okay. That's exactly what I was about to say. Like, it's just not, you know, all right, well, you join, and now all of a sudden you don't have to pay taxes, or you don't have to answer to certain people, or you just got freedom in the neighborhood. Mm-hmm. You can kind of move how you want. You don't have to absolutely, like, use the exact same plug as everybody and stuff like that. Before you can get to that level, of course, there's a lot of stuff that they expect from you. It's more take than give, I would say. Like, okay, they want a lot more from you than they're willing to actually offer you. But, of course, the picture is painted like, you know, this is almost like a 50-50 relationship where, you know, I can tell any young boy or girl out there, you know, if you haven't joined a gang, don't. Especially if somebody is trying to present to you that, you know, oh, this is going to be like a 50-50 family and, you know, brotherhood, sisterhood, and as much as you give is what you're going to get. And I'm like, no, they're going to paint the picture to be what they want it to be. But at the end of the day, trust me, you will be giving up more than yourself than you will ever get from any gang. And it's from any organization that I'm aware of.
No. So they almost like any entity that they want loyalty.
Yes.
That requires loyalty.
Yes.
And silence. Whatever you get in, you need to be silent. That's pretty much prove yourself, whatever trouble you get in.
Yes.
Okay. All right. Yeah. All right. So now that you know, how long did you stay in the gangs?
Well, the thing is, like, I mean, once we take the oath, once you take the oath.
You got to take an oath too?
Yeah.
Wow.
For this organization.
Okay.
Like, you can't never. Like, the oath will kill me, pretty much. So, I will always be, but I'm not functioning. Like,
gotcha.
There's a way that you can, you know, you can get, it's all in kind of like who you know and what you have done.
Mm-hmm.
When the time come, you know, you want to maybe no longer function within the organization. Pretty much, they gonna weigh what you've done, you know, and that's
before
gonna
they can
speak.
Let you out.
Yeah, they gonna like it's gonna speak some type of volumes. If you was a person in the organization that kind of just, you know, you stayed to yourself and you was quiet, and you know, when the time came, they needed you to do something, you may have had to be chosen to do it. Is a lot different than a person that's just gonna be like,
willing.
Send me,
yeah,
you know.
Gotcha.
So, I mean, I'm not too proud to say like. I've done a whole bunch for this organization, you know, so I didn't have, like, when it came to me discussing with, you know, like, my uncles and just people who was just, you know, higher ranking, I was able to sit at the table with a lot of people that some people wouldn't have been able to sit with, and they may have been in the organization for a lot longer than me, because whenever a situation just arose, I just step up, you know, and just because I wanted rank. So bad, just so I can get to the level where there's certain things I want. I was really greedy, and I just saw, like, I don't know, I'm a thinker. Like I told you in the beginning, like, I just saw a bigger picture. So my mindset was never really on, like, oh, well, I'm just so in love with this and that. Like, I saw a lot of things going on that I hated, absolutely hated.
Mm-hmm.
But I got to a place in my life where I love money, fast money, and just the love of money so much, and just to have more and more and more. I just felt like, all right, if I can get ranked, you know, then I can have people under me. I just wanted to get to a place where I can make money in my sleep, pretty much.
Okay.
That was my mind.
So it's like a pill, you know, like a pill.
Wanted that position. Yeah. That's how I wanted it, you know.
Right.
So I was like, man, I'm going to do what I got to do in the beginning, because I knew looking down the line, I was like, I'm going to get to be like this person and that person. And these are who I call, like, shot callers. Like,
mm-hmm.
I knew for a fact that I was going to get to that place. And then as soon as I got to that place, I had, like me and three of my, like, really close friends,
mm-hmm.
who also became a part of the organization. And we always made, like, a pact, like, whoever get ranked first was going to bring the rest of us in. So as soon as I got it, the way God works is, like, I got it. I got locked up. Because I ended up working. That's a. We gotta go back to get to where I'm at right now. Because I don't want to jump into you. So I'm gonna go. We can go on with your question.
We got time.
No, I mean, I gotta be able to get a whole story for you to fully understand, like, where I'm at as far as, like, in the organization. Since 2003, jumped up and just hit. I mean, I was running. As soon as I got in the doors, I just. You know, like, they know that he didn't really have to say something to me twice or ask me to do anything twice. I suffer this one situation we came up on, and I mean, I can't get into too much details, it was asked of us to carry out this particular order that I found out in the midst that it was going to involve a child, like hurting a child. And I grabbed me and my homegirls, absolutely not. And I will be the one that, you know, I'll face whoever I got to face to deal with this, like, because it was very specific instructions. like, dang, why they keep saying go about it like this, go about it like this? So to make a long story short, it involved a pregnant woman. Mm. And it was just it was pretty much to get rid of that whole situation. And because of how I was raised, I'm absolutely not as just not actually very, I mean, out of everything I've done, you know, this is my first time I can honestly say I've told them, like, no, absolutely not, no.
Right.
And I did whatever I got to deal with.
Now, don't they have limitations when it comes to, like, children or something like that? Yeah, don't they supposed to have, like, we got a code. We don't go that far.
Supposedly. Okay. Like, no women, no children, no elderly. Right.
Okay.
But, unfortunately, like, a lot of these people who was the foundation of it in Maryland and Baltimore, like, in D.C., like, man, these guys gone, you know? They dead.
The principal people.
A lot of the people who really stood for something. And because it didn't start out, it wasn't meant to be. It was never really meant to be a gang. It really started out with, like, some good qualities and really helping the community and really really uplifting the neighborhood. And drugs came in and kind of just tore that whole structure down
to where
it started turning into a lot of just crime and violence, and we began hurting one another, you know. Initially it was really something that some people brought together to actually uplift the community and help children, especially like feeding children and a bunch of reading programs, a bunch of stuff like that.
Okay.
But then we got egos and stuff got in the way. And then when the drugs and that money, you know, I watched it, and it wasn't like I've been so long. I know, but I hear the stories and just comparing from when I stepped in to, you know, the stories that I was told. I'm like, dang, they just brought it down. It's crumbled to right now. And it's like, I mean, it's a fully functioning gang.
Yeah.
Like they gang, people are gang banging.
Right.
You know, like just in 2003 when we couldn't even call ourselves a gang, and we couldn't function like a gang. We couldn't do, you know, we had rules that would set us apart from gangs. Yes, just to set us apart from the gang. So it's just a little crazy right now, because I mean, like, the young children, they don't know the book value of it, you know. I had to study. It wasn't no easy thing. It wasn't like how it is now. You can just get in, get jumped in, get brought in. You can pay your way in. It's a bunch of crazy stuff going on with it right now. But like back then, you had to learn them. You had to learn them rules. You had to learn them bylaws. You had every regulation, and it was consequences to everything from the biggest violation to the smallest one. I mean, small things just like being intoxicated in public will get you sanctioned.
Oh, okay. Now, even though they lost it, was it because of the generation gap or just different cats coming in with a different idea of how we wanted to do things?
Just losing a lot of the older guys to either being strung out on drugs or getting a lot of federal time or being killed, to now you have, like, well, let's just say back then, we have, like, I mean, these guys are, like, 55, 65 years old. So, you know, they know the foundation.
Right.
And they was carrying a little different. Now they all gone, passed away. So now you got you have people that's high ranking in their 20s.
Right.
They don't know, you know, so their mindset is this, oh, we did what? Kill them. You know, they don't care. Just the whole mindset of it changed so much to this, I don't know, it's totally different from when I was able to, by the grace of God, I was able to give my time, what they would say, kind of say, give your time back. Like, you know, listen, I want to go a different route, you know, from that time, and just looking back, you know, from back to the beginning. And now, totally different. It's totally different.
So what made you decide to walk away from it? I know you had to go through a process to walk away from it. But
so
what incident came up to say, you know what, got to be another way besides your upbringing?
To me, all right, the background is that I was always saved. Like I accepted Jesus Christ as my personal savior at a young age. And like I said, I never needed the protection. I just was hard-headed, and I just saw things. I always liked real nice things, and I went that route. So I think the turning point was I caught a charge. I caught an attempt murder charge. This was in 2011, and that's why I said I wanted to kind of like tell the whole story about. And when I first, I'm gonna answer the question, but let me go back.
But go ahead, that's fine. Just walk us to that.
Yeah, when I first took the oath, I sat amongst some people. We was going over. They were going over ways to infiltrate Baltimore City jails. A way for to get the organization to be able to kind of run. I want to be able to say it without. There's no way I'm gonna be able to say it without saying it, so I'm gonna say it. Like, a way to be able to bring the organization in and out the jail as much as they please. Mm-hmm. Of course, if you got people in there doing time, they can't leave when they want. So, because I didn't have a record, you know, it was like, hey, you should sign up, you know, try to become a correctional officer. I mean, this will really help us out, bump you up. Yeah. So that's what I decided to do. So I took on this job just to be of, you know, assistance. And did that for about 8 years, I think.
Yeah.
About 8 years. So that brings me up to the charge. And so I'm a correctional officer. During the time that I got the attempt murder charge, about not even a year before I caught the attempt murder charge, I was just locked up for, I had a bunch of charges, maybe like 8 charges, all stemming around conspiracy and robbery. And it's supposedly of allegedly a police officer. I ain't gonna get into that though.
Okay.
Yeah, police officer. So I could have settled out of court if I would have put $7,000 in her pocket, but I fought it.
Yeah.
And all this was all because of, again, this organization. This particular police officer was definitely in a different organization, but was in an organization.
It was different, not in the police organization, but a different organization.
That's right.
Okay, yes. Gotcha.
But a police officer.
Yeah.
It is what it is, baby.
Undercover, we might say. Yeah, I got you.
Yeah.
Yeah, so.
We thought they just undercover in the church. Go ahead.
All right.
Go ahead.
That's
good. All right. Okay.
That's
yeah, so,
you're right. It's coming too.
Yeah.
So we I ended up, because I was a correctional officer, I ended up getting a no bail, because remember I had just beat that other charge that I was fighting. So I got a no bail. I had to sit over there around Christmas time. Central booking, the commissioner, and, you know, that higher staff, they go on their little vacation. So I had to sit there and wait to see to get a bail review to see if I could get a bail. And because I was a correctional officer, they had to put me on PC. I was just working at this exact same jail that I'm now locked up in. Maybe a couple weeks ago, I was just working there, the exact same jail, WDC. I'm just working there. So now I'm locked up in there. They have to put me on PC because, you know, of my job status. My same jail where I worked at. No, all my co-workers, they now locking me in. And they trying to bring me some chicken. They was definitely trying to feed me. I was so sick. They was looking out for me. They love me. And I love them. Like, I had a lot of good people. You know, they was just looking out for me, but I was sick. I couldn't eat. I couldn't sleep. I just, that no bail, I just had my mind just like, I mean, there's nothing you could do with the no bail. It's just nothing. And they would have told me $1 million, I probably would have still been sick, but it would have made me feel like I can fight something. You know? I got a chance, but the no bail had me sick. Couldn't eat, none of that. So I had time. I'm nothing but time.
Okay.
Just waiting for, you know, the commissioner and them to come back so I can go to bail review. So I'm just sitting in there. PC is 23 hours locked in your cell and 1 hour out. And at 1 hour, You have to be able to shower, make your phone call, you know, take care of any other little stuff you need to take care of. You can try to grab some books and stuff like that. So I didn't want nothing but the Bible. I didn't want nothing but the Bible. So I'm just in there reading, you know, just things that I already knew. And as even as much as I would try to read, I just kept hearing God, like, you know, I'm going to be honest. I'm questioning God, like, why? Like, of all the things I've ever done, I'm really over the jail, locked up where I was just working a couple weeks ago for something that wasn't, I was on a attempt murder charge, and I didn't, it wasn't my intent. Like, it wasn't even like I was really attempting to murder anybody. Right. So I just looking like, why this? All the things that I actually intended on doing and made a, you know, a conscious decision to do, I never got jammed up.
Right.
But now it's like I didn't intentionally try to kill a person. I mean, I got into a fight. One thing led to another, but I didn't intentionally try to kill a person. Right. But now I'm sitting in the jail with a no bail on an attempt murder charge. So I did. I'm like, God, what's up? Like, why? You know? So as I'm reading, it's like, I felt like I was reading, but I felt like I wasn't understanding what I was reading. It was strange because it's like I never gone through that before. So I would just start all over and try to start reading again. But so I just heard the voice of God so clear, you know, at that time. Like I heard the voice of God so clear. So God, you know, pretty much God was just ministering to me like, like this, you know how bad I've been trying to get your attention. Like, you know it.
My God.
You know? And yes, I couldn't, and I had to be honest and be like, yeah, like because I really did hear the voice of God. You know, yes, I really knew. Like, I'm like, this is like, God was trying to get my attention years.
Yeah.
So I had the opportunity to just surrender without that sacrifice. But because of my disobedience, you know, I chose to be disobedient, yeah. And we know what the Bible says. You know, I mean, obedience is better than sacrifice. But I didn't, you know, my disobedience led to that. I had no other choice but to be there because, you know, God had to get my attention. And by that way, that's what he used. I mean, so it's like I'm grateful because it just opened up my eyes and opened up my mind to so many things. It just gave me a lot of just quiet time. I mean, not even reading. Like, I had the Bible in there, but I really felt like it wasn't about that at that moment. It wasn't even about reading the word. It was more so about God, that one-on-one, just, you know, the Holy Spirit just ministering to me, yeah, and restoring me without the word, you know. So almost like an awakening, almost like a, you know, a brand new enlightened period, you know, right, what I'm saying? Where it was like God reminded me of, like, the beginning of, like, when I chose him, you know, when I was chosen. And I said yes, like, you know. So God reminded me of, like, you doing this, you doing that, you doing this, you doing that, like, what about me, you know, what about me, you know. So I've been trying to get your attention, because in the midst of doing things, I promise you, I would hear the word of God, but I would hear my aunts. I would hear my first lady's voice. Yeah, it was strange, you know. I mean, in a commission of doing crimes, I would really hear the word of God. Because, it's like I would hear the word, but the voice would be my first lady's voice, you know. And I was just constantly, I'm familiar with it. And this is the person who, you know, makes sure that I'm covered. It's the person who's, no matter what I'm doing, this is the person who's going to guide me through the word. So it was like sometimes, I'm talking about right in the midst, in the commission of it, while I'm breaking the law, I would hear the word of God.
Easily.
But I would hear it from my first lady saying it. So God just, during that time, he was reminding me of stuff like that. Like, you know, I was giving you ways out. I was covering you. I was protecting you. I was doing this. I was doing that. And then you got so involved in that you totally forgot about me. It was just like, you know, so it is what it is. You know, and that was my turning point. When I got home,
before you got home, you called us.
Yeah, yeah.
Myself, First Lady, you talked to your mother. Mm-hmm. I remember that day. You called me and said, I need to talk to you.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. And that's the ministry of reconciliation.
That's it, right there.
She came and said, I apologize. I'm sorry. Yes, da da da. And I'm like, wow, okay.
Yeah.
You know,
yeah.
But those are the, that's the moment. For me, that was the moment. You know, yes, I said, okay, God, I hear you. So, matter of fact, I can go before that. When we used to have the candy feast, you can get back to your story, but we used to have the candy feast. We had the little, the children, the young children, get up, get a candy bar, and preach on it through scripture. Man, them children tore them scripture up. I mean, man, I still got them on tape. Because the guy told me you ought to put it in a book and sell it. He said, because that's rich. Mm-hmm. And so they was awesome then. I'm talking about 10,
yeah.
8, 10 years old.
Yeah.
They expounded on a candy bar with the gospel. Good and plenty.
Mm-hmm.
Good and plenty.
Joy. I mean, man, they.
I had now and later.
You had now and later.
I had now and later.
But she had to remember that while she was there, though. Remember now and later.
Mm-hmm.
But that's how I knew they had anointing and a calling on their life, because God showed me then. He said, man, look at that. And I'm like, wow. You know, but I kept it to myself. But those who have ears or spiritual mind, they knew it too. That's why I know it's not hard to see y'all go forth.
Yeah.
This is not an issue for us, you know, because we saw it when you was in y'all younger stage. But back to, you said once you got home.
Yeah, so once I got home, well, it wasn't as soon as I got home, but after you know, I started working on a case. This is another way of how God, you know, operates. Once I got back to a place where I could start reading the Word,
mm-hmm.
right? Because after I talked to God, and I remember calling y'all, because I remember the Holy Spirit. I wish I could remember the whole thing. The Holy Spirit administered something to me about all the relationships. He was just talking to me about all the relationships that I had damaged, because he ministered to me that my, you know, people look up to me. Like, I have this certain aura, and he was just telling me, like, you letting so many people down with what you're doing. He was like, even in the, you know, even in this organization that you in, and seeing the stuff that they were getting these young kids to do. I mean, 12 years old, weapons, I mean, big guns, and, you know, just big drugs and stuff like that. And it's like my love for children, but, you know, I won't really step in. You know, it got to a point where I started, even before I left, I started, you know, noticing little stuff, and I just started ministering, you know. So, but anyway, after I start fighting my case and everything, I ran into one of my old friends. He was locked up, and he had came home, right? I left from over to jail at the beginning of January, and this was like maybe like February.
Y'all
right?
grew up together.
We came up together.
Right, pretty much.
We didn't grow up together, but we kind of came up in the ranks and stuff together. And well, he outranked me a whole lot.
Okay.
He was doing the football. 10 years longer than me. So anyway, and I was just telling him everything, you know, about where I was at, and that, you know, I was locked up. I was like, man, God was in there talking to me. And he was like, yeah, like, well, really, what about? And I just was telling him, he just broke out in tears. And he was like, that's crazy, because he was like, I've been feeling like a greater power is, you know, speaking to me and is, you know, trying to get me to go a different route or whatever. Mm-hmm. And I was like, wow. He was like, look, I'm all for that. He said, what you need from me, right?
Mm.
Keep in mind what I was about to say, how God works. When I finally went to bail review, that judge, she wasn't cutting nobody no slack. If you had a bail, she was raising your bail. And if you had a no bail, she was sending you back with that no bail. And some people was this, and I mean, she was. I mean, it was a mess. Yeah, but she was ruthless. You know what I mean? And then when I was like shaking my head because I kept seeing my mother and my aunt there. I kept seeing them put their heads down every time she sent somebody away. I watched them on the screen mm-hmm. and the holding cell, so I could see my family in there. And like, oh, I was like, oh, I should start praying like, God, like, don't please don't let me get all the way to this point to have to go back upstairs in that box. And I call it a box because I mean I'm very claustrophobic. I got asthma and all that. And I mean that was a rough situation for me. The only way I was able to get air, I used to have to lay on the floor, put my nose underneath the door just to get some cool air or whatever. So yeah. I didn't want to go back in that box for nothing. So when I finally walked up to the front, the judge said, "Oh, Lane. Oh, I was already prepared for you." She asked the prosecutor and the state's what's the other people that been there?
State's attorney.
What in the state's attorney?
Defendant.
It may have been the state's attorney. I don't know. Anyway, so she was like, "So what y'all have?" So the guy, he was pretty much saying, he jumped up. He was like, "Listen, now it's like back to back, you know, arrest for her, and is always violent, and you know he just running me down to the ground, you know, and I stood there quiet, which is hard for me. I didn't say nothing. I just, not a mumbling word.
Lord will fight you
if you hold your peace, and that's what was going on. I didn't say nothing, and my lawyer didn't say nothing either, which was strange. My lawyer let this man get all of that stuff out, right? And after he said all of this stuff, the judge said, "Well, what do you have?" Asked my lawyer. She said, "What are you willing to work with?" And my lawyer said, "Well, we want a $25,000 bill. We can work with that." And the judge said, "Well, that's a little bit too much." She said, "But before she even stepped in here, I was already willing to do something on her behalf."
Wow.
She said, $50,000 bill, you know, if they can post that, whatever, 1%, then we can have her out of here today. So my judge did, you know, my lawyer started playing lawyer. So my lawyer would say, "Okay, well, what about 35 or something like that?" However it went, we got it down close to about that 25 that he was trying to get. So, yeah, I mean, it's just God is just awesome. So anyway, said that to say, I explained all this to my brother when I got out, and you know, after he broke down and was sharing some stuff with me at the time, he had came home from jail and went into a program, and this was the first time that since I've known this man for years that he has ever been in a program. Now, keep in mind, this was a big time drug dealer, but that started abusing drugs. So, you know that story. Yeah. Right, so.
No question.
It was never his M.O. I mean, that's all he talk about. When he's in jail, that's all he talk about is getting out to get high. That's all he talk about. So for this to be his verbiage, you know, we both knew that we were somewhere different.
Okay.
So he said, "Sis," he said, "whatever you need from me, you know, I got you." So I said, "Only thing I want to do is walk. That's all I want, with no strings attached." He let me know if you know if you do this, you can't call on them for nothing. You can't call on us for nothing. You need whatever, anything, money, help, protection, whatever. I said, "I don't need it." You know, I said, "I don't need it." Said, "You sure?" I said, "I'm positive." Said, "All right, let me make some phone calls." And maybe 3 or 4 days, he called me back. And he said, "Can you come outside?" And I said, "Yeah, where you want to meet at?" He told me where we want to meet at. And we met down there. And as I'm walking up to him, he said, "Shorty, I got some good news for you." I already knew what it was. He said, "Say no more," right? And we hugged, and that was it.
That was it?
That was it.
You ain't going to have to go to no board?
No, nothing. I mean, there's certain... He was in. I mean, I can't call out what his position is.
Well, I got you.
Well, yeah. And then, you know, he went home. You know, he he passed away. That's why I was getting a little emotional. But he ended up passing away a little bit after that. I had a little trouble because certain people he didn't go into. Like, he stayed where our regime is over East Baltimore, Northeast Baltimore, in the central location of Baltimore. But he didn't take it to, it didn't reach everywhere that it should have.
It should have been a little higher.
Right. So gotcha. So now at this point, I got people who they watching the way that I'm moving. They kind of don't know, and I really don't got an answer to them. Mm-hmm. So I didn't. So they just start stirring stuff up. Right. So I had a little bit that I had to go face some little stuff and deal with some little stuff. But even in the midst of all that, I mean, I never, no sanctions. I never got beat. I never got touched. Mm-hmm. No, never got shot, stabbed, none of that stuff. And I've seen it go down. Definitely seen it go down.
Well, check this out. We're going to take a break, a couple minute break, and we're going to come back. And Jovan going to tell us how she got delivered and how she accepted more of Christ, to walk in Christ even the more. We'll be right back. God bless you. Good evening, my brothers and sisters. We're back to the Bishop Hour. We have this young lady, Javon Lane, here sharing us the moments or her experience that she played in the game. And we just want to help other young people that's maybe wavering and don't know how to get out, don't know how to talk, don't know who to talk to. Amen. But if you call 1-855-493-6499, that's 1-855-493-6499. And we're going to still be around. So if you want to call and you even want to talk to her, amen, she can give you some advice, some lead you to a direction, amen. The record she took, amen, because it still works. The blood still works, and Christ still works, and so we're just excited. So now we're going to get back, and we're going to come down to you have made the decision to get out. The brother spoke for you on your behalf to be out, amen. And then take us from there.
Yeah, okay, so it started with him. First he presented it as though I didn't have to pay the dues, so that was the first part of it. Mm-hmm. So I got released from that, went back. Got me released from functioning. I don't need anything from them. They don't, you know, need anything from me. We are able to go separate ways. Like I did explain from the beginning, once you take the oath, you can't give it back. It's just, you know, it's tied to death. And, I mean, it's just not that serious for me to die, you know, over something like that. Mm-hmm. So, yeah, I mean, once you are that, you always are, but, you know, you don't have to function.
Okay.
And so, I mean, I really would love to just put it out there, you know, just in case if it's any young people listening, you don't even really have to be a young person. You know, if your back is against the wall and you might find yourself wondering if this, you know, will be a choice that you would want to make, or maybe you feel like you can obtain or is something to gain from being in one of these organizations or being a part of a gang or whatever, mm-hmm. you know, you may want to call it. Is this not the right route to go? Mm-hmm. And I promise you that. I mean, there it's going to be presented as if this is something that is, you know, you're only going to see the good and the upside of this until you are really fully in it and functioning, and then you're going to realize that, you know, There's a lot that come with it, and pretty much you putting your life on the line, and it's just not that serious. I mean, God loves us so much, you know, that there are so many other options and so many ways out. You know, anything that you need, I promise you that you can find just having a relationship with God, you know, yeah. allowing Jesus as your personal Savior and talking to Him through prayer. You know what I'm saying? If there's anything that you need, trust and believe that God will provide it.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, and so it's like I'm not comfortable with saying, because I've been in places where I feel like, you know, kids take it the wrong way, and it's almost as if they feel like I'm glorifying it. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? Because the things I'm saying, you know, I watch it put a smile on children's face, but not when you turn down your community and you killing your own.
Yeah.
And at the end of the day, you know, I wasted a whole bunch of time doing that when I could have been putting that time and energy into, you know, my purpose and to what God, you know, chose me to do.
Amen. Amen. Now, we've got about 10 minutes, but even in that, your family was protected. They never threatened you about your family or nothing like that, right? It was just you taking the oath for just you.
Yeah.
Your family was out of it.
Yeah, and
What I mean is sometimes they try to hold your family over you to control you.
Oh, no.
Like your parents, your siblings, and that kind of thing. No. There wasn't nothing like that.
No. Okay. Not for me. Like I said, I was able to, you know, be amongst like some very high ranking people, and my brother that I, you know, the person mm-hmm. who I just explained to you about.
Right.
Yeah, he has too much power and too much influence
to
let something like that go down.
Okay.
Yeah.
Good. Now that you got out, where was God leading you from there? Now that you got out,
I got out jail. I got out of the organization, and you know, I just started putting more of my time and my energy a lot back into reading, and it just reestablishing my relationship with God, because I always had one.
Mm-hmm.
You know, just like I was talking to a brother earlier, and we was talking about the oath and how, you know, once you take it, you can't never give it back. And pretty much that's the same thing as being saved, you know, salvation. Like, once you have it, You know, you can never give that back. Yes, so you will have to remove yourself, you know, from the hands of God. So I was already there. So I just started like trying to just reestablishing my relationship with God, talking to him more and stuff like that. And then I got to a place where you know how sometimes when your back is against the wall and you say a bunch of stuff and you make a bunch of promises and stuff, and that's kind of what I did in order to get out of jail. I was serious about leaving that organization alone because I never went back. I never went back, but other things I picked back up, you know, other things I start getting into, you know. And then again, I mean, God has ways to just get my attention. I mean, unfortunately with me is always the hard way, but I thank God that it's just a way.
Yeah,
you know, that there is a way. Yeah. And there
is.
You know,
he is that. The way. A way. I would preach that one.
He always provide a way.
Yeah.
You know, so I'm just so thankful and so grateful that, you know, he provided a way. He gave me another chance after that last chance. After that last chance, he gave me another chance. So that's where I'm at now. And I got to a place where my body was attacked. And I just knew I was like, everything in my life was pretty much under attack, you know.
Right.
Everything, my mind, because I went through just a bunch of stuff. I'm gonna just say that, you know, I had to get back to a place where I can hear clear, because I knew that I was, you know, I wanted my relationship with Christ to grow, and I just wanted to get strong in Him. I wanted Him to get strong in me. I wanted that light to shine brighter, you know. So I had to let go of a lot of things. I had to go through detox. I just had to, there's a lot of things that I had to do. And, you know, just making that decision. I was under attack. I know I felt it.
Right.
Everything, every aspect of my life fell under attack pretty much. Yeah. And throughout that attack, like I said, God will give you options prior to it. You, sometimes you don't even have to go through the unnecessary stuff, you know, just surrender. And that yes will change everything.
My, yes, sir.
Jesus Christ, you know what I mean? Yeah. I was.
And it would challenge you, too. The yes would challenge you. Yes,
absolutely.
Yes, no question.
So that's where I'm at now, just accepting my my calling, you know, where God has been trying to lead me at for so many years. Even when I was in the organization, I wish I could, my friends could be here, like they'll tell you. I always minister to people. Like, I mean, it could be some crazy stuff going on in the mix. I mean, they call me crazy. They call me crazy because
gifts show up.
Knowing that we even planning to do something wrong, I still pray. Like, I still ask for protection. I know for a fact that I needed God the whole time. I know it, you know. So they'll tell you, like, man, you've been doing that. Even back then, you know, like, you always wanted to pray. You always was ministering. You always was talking to us about certain stuff. And, you know, so it's kind of in me, you know, I guess.
Yeah,
so,
it's in you. No question about it. What made me think about when you were saying the oath that you make with the organization? God made an oath with you.
Amen.
He said, my word cannot come back void, but it has to accomplish what he set it out. So despite of what you and I, the decisions we made, bad or good, once God made an oath with us, he keeps it, you know. And so I'm excited for you. I'm excited that you went this route. And nobody want to say that. I'm glad you went this route.
Amen.
Because you're more powerful. You'll be more effective in the kingdom because they're going to be people are going to be wanting this,
yes,
you know. And so,
Amen. And
I won't be identified with them. Why? Because I haven't been there.
Yes, sir.
But you've been there. So you can identify with them. You can get to the root of the issue. And the problem in the kingdom, we don't get to the root of things.
That's
we
right.
need to get to the root of it. When you can get to the root of, you can free people up and have them make better decisions. So I'm proud of you. I'm excited for you. I'm excited.
You.
Not only you in our ministry, but I'm just excited that you're in the ministry of Jesus Christ. You know,
Amen.
And it's been a long time coming. And we gonna do this thing, amen. We gonna
amen.
Do this thing, and we gotta rectify people back to God, restore people back to God, because people are broken, and they get so broken they make broken decisions. And so we want to help people make a better decision and a life decision, amen. Because Christ is the life, amen. So I'm excited. You want to say something? Come on, talk to us, Brother Wilbur. He's a preacher now.
I ain't no preacher.
Yeah, he a preacher. He a preacher now.
No
he been a preacher for years, but he's official now.
I ain't no preacher.
Come on.
Hey, family. How you doing?
Bless you, man.
Hey, man. I'd like to say that I love Jovan. I've been loving her for a long time.
Love you more.
Yeah. She was my only woman drummer on Redeem. So, you know, we have a special connection. But I also was with you in the jail together. And I just thank God for knowing you and how you changed. And people came to me with those accusations when we was in the jail. But because you was my family, I protected your name.
Amen.
Regardless of what it was right or wrong, I didn't know. I never asked you about that question until today, until the beginning of this show.
That's right.
Because she's my family. And my thing is that I never asked. I never asked nobody in the family. Mm-hmm. Did I, Bishop? Never asked nobody in the family, even though I worked with her. Even though we was in the same jail. And the thing about it is that I didn't know what was going on. You didn't involve me. People just know we was connected. Oh, yeah. They knew that was my little sister there. Right. They knew she played for me and all that stuff. And I just thank God for your life.
Yeah.
If don't nobody else, because now is the time for the ministry to start where you are.
Amen.
Even with me, I thought it was back then, but I'm more needed now with the radicalness. I was too far advanced back then. People was crucifying me and some more stuff. You can't talk about that in the church. Now I'm going to the clubs.
Yeah.
But I just thank God for you coming here today at this studio. And you're my friend, and I thank Bishop for bringing you here.
Oh, yeah.
You know, y'all been my family forever. And I just had to come on. Normally, I don't do this show. I don't come on nobody's show and say nothing. Normally, I don't do that. I stay over there and stay to myself and holler.
But
she my friend.
Your bones.
But she my friend, you know, and I'm connected to her. So I just wanted to say that, you know, no matter what, it's still family. We still protect. So I'm done. All right.
Okay. God bless you. Thank you, Brother Wilbert. Now, my brothers and sisters, we're going to decrease. Amen. And we pray that this touch you, just keep on. If you want to tap into it again, we'll be on iRadio, iTunes, YouTube, Amen, Spotify. We're going to be on all kinds of things. So if you want to go back and re-air this, you can do that. Amen.
Apple Podcast.
Amen. And so we just excited. We thank Jovan again, Jovan Lane, for coming and sharing with us. And we pray that she strengthens somebody or enlightens someone or even lifts someone up tonight. And so we just thank God. For God be the glory for the great thing he's still doing. God bless you.
God bless you.